It was Easter. And here we are, time flies, 2 weeks removed from Easter. But I want for just a moment for you to recapture that vibe of Easter. And if you'll remember, we talked about how Jesus rose Lazarus from the grave. And then we talked about how Jesus rose from the grave to provide salvation for all of us. Now, what I want you to think about for just a moment is that Lazarus, that story about Lazarus shows how much Jesus loved him. What a deep love Jesus had for his friend, Lazarus, his sisters, Mary and Martha. But then when you think about the resurrection of Jesus, you realize that that love that he had for his friends during his earthly ministry is a love that he also shares with all of us. He loves us. He died on the cross, and he rose again so that we could have the hope of resurrection life. So when we think about this, we realize that the stories in the New Testament about Jesus' resurrection are showcases of his love for his friends, his power over death, and the freedom that he provides each and every one of us. Friends, we do have an amazing faith, an amazing hope in Jesus. And I hope today these clouds and the rain that's falling won't damper that view for you, that you will remember how much God truly loves you. But let's also come to grips with one sad reality. Though Jesus' love is tremendous and powerful, the greatest force in all the world, we are all aware of the fact that many people, maybe even some of us in this room, have yet to experience that love. In fact, there are some people that seem to even be pushing against that love and rejecting it outright. And when we, as people of faith, and many of you in this room are, when we think about the amazing gift of faith, it is hard for us to fathom how it is possible for anyone to reject a love like this. And so today what I want to do is show you a couple of passages of Scripture that give us some insight, and I think not only show us why it is so difficult for some people to believe, I think if we will open our hearts and minds, I think we'll begin to discover why it's hard sometimes for us to really live a life of faith. You see, once you come to know Jesus, it's not like from that point on you just believe and you don't have any problems and things go well. No, we will struggle with trusting in Jesus and believing in Jesus all throughout our lives, sometimes not that much, other times greatly, because our circumstances in life can often cause us to question and to think deeply about who we are and who Jesus is. And so today, I really want to challenge each of you to open your hearts to what the Word has to say to us, because I hope you'll see that God is at work. His love is great, and there's evidence of that all around us, enough to anchor us during the storm. But sometimes we do lose sight of who Jesus is and what he's done for us. So if you have your Bibles, I want to take you to the very end of the story of Lazarus. And it's so interesting that after such a great miracle, a man who was dead for 4 days, Jesus brings back to life. And then hear this. Many of the Jews, therefore, who had come with Mary and had seen what he did, believed in him. Now, that's what we expect to hear. But verse 46 is what we don't expect to hear. But some of them went to the Pharisees and told them what Jesus had done. So the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered the council and said, "What are we to do? For this man performs many signs. If we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him." Now notice, they're not saying that in a positive fashion. "And the Romans will come and take away both our place and our nation." Notice the pronoun there, our. "But one of them, Caiaphas, who was the high priest that year, said to them, 'You know nothing at all.'" He was a humble man, obviously. "Nor do you understand that it is better for you that one man should die for the people, not that the whole nation should perish." He did not say this of his own accord, but being high priest that year, he prophesied that Jesus would die for the nation, and not for the nation only, but also to gather into one the children of God who were scattered abroad. So from that day on, they made plans to put him to death. Wow. Jesus brings somebody back from the grave, and these guys, these Pharisees and scribes, they want to literally kill him. Kill Jesus. "Jesus, therefore, no longer walked openly among the Jews, but went from there to the region near the wilderness, to a town called Ephraim, and there he stayed with the disciples. Now, the Passover of the Jews was at hand, and many went up from the country to Jerusalem before the Passover to purify themselves. They were looking for Jesus and saying to one another as they stood in the temple, "What do you think? That he will not come to the feast at all?" Now the chief priests and the Pharisees had given orders that if anyone knew where he was, he should let them know so that they might arrest him. Now, if you'll go with me to the 12th chapter, just a page over, and I want to take you to verse 36, the second half of verse 36. Notice this. This is almost a commentary, if you will, as to why there is so much unbelief in a passage like the one I just read and all throughout this part of John's gospel. Notice this. When Jesus had said these things, he departed and hid himself from them. Though he had done so many signs before them, they still did not believe in him. Verse 37 is key. He had done many signs before them, and yet they still did not believe him. So that the words spoken by the prophet Isaiah might be fulfilled, "Lord, who has believed what he heard from us, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed?" Therefore, they could not believe, for again Isaiah said, "He has blinded their eyes and hardened their hearts, lest they see with their eyes and understand with their hearts and turn, and I would heal them." Isaiah said these things because he saw his glory and spoke of him. Nevertheless, many, even of the authorities, believed in him, but for fear of the Pharisees, they did not confess it so that they would not be put out of the synagogue. For they love the glory that comes from man more than the glory that comes from God. Let's pray. Lord, we ask that in this moment that you will help us to discern your glory. And God, no matter what our tradition is, no matter how long we've been in church, I pray, God, that we will not lose sight of your glory, the glory that comes from you, O God. Let us know your love and power this morning, and please help us to believe. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I've said this before. I hope you believe it's true. Your faith in Christ, if you're here this morning and you have faith in Christ, this is the greatest treasure. This is the greatest treasure God has ever given you. The ability to believe in God and to know that he is with you. A treasure, by definition, is something valuable, and things that are valuable are often rare. I think that it's hard for us to think about faith in terms of rarity because many of you, like me, were blessed to be brought up in a church environment. You've been around good Christian people maybe all of your life. But I want you to know that that gift of belief that you have and cherish so much, you are in a vast minority when it comes to the grand scheme of things. Even in this town that has so many churches, as we've talked about before, so very few people on a regular basis are exercising their faith. Many, many people choose not to exercise their faith or in any way show that they believe in God. Now, when you ask people in a town like ours, in a more rural setting like this, many people will say that they believe in God. But we don't want to question that. It's not our job to judge, except for we must realize that a person who says they believe and yet no part of their life has been impacted by that belief, we need to just consider that there's an inconsistency there. Maybe one that's very deadly, spiritually speaking. Belief is a gift. And it's not a gift given to those who have exemplar moral character. It's not about your heritage. It's not about how firm the foundation was that you were brought up in. I think that helps. But ultimately, belief is something between you and God. It's something that God has to touch your heart with, and you are your eyes are opened to that reality. God's grace is powerful. He loves us. He surrounds us with beautiful gifts and a lot of grace. But grace, by its nature and by design, is non-obtrusive. God's not going to force belief on you. It doesn't work quite that way. He reveals his truth, and you can receive that truth, but many do not. I do. I have to ask the question, Why is it so difficult to believe in Jesus? Why is a passage like John 11 even here? It shouldn't be there. It's Jesus we're talking about here. He's raising people from the dead. He's preaching the Word of God like it's never been preached before. For those of you who think that maybe, you know, if we just had better leaders or better preachers in churches across America, that would do the trick. Listen, Jesus was the best of the best. And many people listened to him and walked away and didn't believe. So it's not the message or the messenger. At some point, it's you and me where we hear the truth and we receive it. There's an onus. There's a responsibility. I don't pretend to know all the ins and outs of this, but somewhere along the line, God speaks and you receive that truth and you believe. And so today, what we want to do is ask, where you stand before God. What truly is in your heart? What choice is there to make? For many people, the easy way out is unbelief. Unbelief is the easy way out. It's the way that you can kind of keep things the way you want them and keep your life ordered as you would order it. But I want to tell you, like Lazarus, you're going to find a grave if that's your angle. You see, there is a grave waiting for all of us. That's true. But there's eternal death for those who do not hear the word of God and humble their heart. And what I want you to see in this passage is it's not just a lack of belief. There's violent unbelief in this passage. So when people turn their hearts from God, it may start very subtly. You may be in a place right now where your mind is semi-open to the gospel truth. But the longer you resist, the harder your heart becomes. And we can see evidence in our culture today of what happens when people just go full-fledged anti-Christ, anti-church, anti-faith. It's out there for us to see. And there is violent unbelief in the world. And I fear that Americans are going to experience more of this. Our brothers and sisters in the Middle East and in North Africa and in places in Southeast Asia are already feeling the fires of persecution because of violent unbelief. And we need to be ready for that in this country too. And we need to understand why that unbelief is present. So let me just point out a few things that God's Word shows us today about unbelief. And I pray that if you are in that place where right now you are not a professing, believing Christian, that you will hear the Word of God and hear and feel the love of Jesus and turn from your sin. So why is belief so difficult? The first thing I want to show you is that the truth is seeing isn't believing. How many of you, and I don't want you to raise your hand, I don't want to embarrass anybody, but how many of you have had the experience of sharing the gospel with someone and being unsuccessful? I'll raise my hand because most of the time, it seems like I fail. If you have tried to share Jesus, you have met with failure. Now, the question is that your fault? Did you not pay attention in Sunday school? Were you not there for the faith training all those years ago? Is it your fault? Is it your poor methodology? Let me tell you something. Someone will tell you that it is, and his name is Satan. The devil will always tell you that people don't come to know Jesus because you don't do it right, or you're a failure, or you don't know how to share Jesus. Let me tell you, that's what the enemy wants to do. He wants to discourage you from ever even starting to share your faith. But I want to tell you, if you share your faith, you will be, more often than not, unsuccessful. But I want to encourage you to give it a whirl anyway, because you never know, and you really do, you never know where God might work. He works in the most unexpected places. You see, if you share the gospel, the problem isn't you. If you're not sharing the gospel, well then yeah, we have to say the problem might be you. If you're not sharing the gospel at all, well then of course no one is going to come to know the Lord through the work that God does through you, in you and through you. You have to be looking for those opportunities. They're out there. But see, the problem is when people don't believe, it's not because you didn't do it right. It's because unbelief is a major problem in the hearts of most, if not all, human beings. We all struggle in this area, and conversion is a work of God. Unsuccessful witnessing is hard on our hearts, friends. It is. I can tell you that as a young man, my mom and dad gave me opportunities to go out and you know, witness to people. They taught me how to share my faith. And I can remember as a young man having doors closed in my face and things of that nature. I want to tell you, I don't care how old you are, that is not a fun experience. And being unsuccessful here, it is so easy to just give up. And I think many of us sadly have. We can talk about the lack of evangelism in our church. My question is, though, is where are we contributing? Because if we're just pointing the fact out and not doing anything about it, well, then we're the problem, not the solution. And I believe that many times when it comes to sharing the gospel, we do it sometimes with friends and neighbors for years, right? Have you had that experience where you've just had somebody on your mind or on your heart for years and years and years? And it's kind of like the experience of running on a treadmill, and you're moving all the time, you're trying all the time, but you just don't get anywhere. Have any of you, like me, found yourself in those moments saying things like this? Oh, Lord, this person, I love them so much. I want to see them come to know you. And I just pray. I've read your Bible enough to know that you're a miracle-working God. So I'm going to call in a favor. God, will you just do a great miracle in their presence so that they'll believe? Maybe none of you are that way. I'm sure your faith is so much stronger than mine. So you would never do that. I have literally prayed that way. Come on, God. I want to see you do something big time. I want to see a big sign, a big miracle, so that bitterness, that anger, that hard heart can be washed away. Please, God, do that. It's been my prayer many times. But I want to tell you, this passage makes it clear that all the signs in the world can't change a heart of unbelief on its own. Many of the Jews, verse 11:45, look, many of the Jews who saw what he did, and again, that's the raising of Lazarus, believed in him. So know this, yes, when God moves, many people can be touched by this. I don't think there's anything wrong with us praying for God to move in miraculous fashion. If we want to see 150 souls saved, I believe God may have to move in miraculous fashion. That'd be great, but don't think that that alone will do it. Don't think that it's going to take a Lazarus coming out of the grave, although that'd be great if we could see somebody restored to life like that, but that isn't necessarily what will happen. Look at verse 46. Look how sad the human heart can be. But some of them went to the Pharisees and told them what Jesus had done. Friends, they didn't go to the Pharisees to say, hey, Jesus is doing great things. You need to come see this and believe. No, they went to the Pharisees to say, hey, this guy is starting to get a following, and he's going to take power away from you. Let me throw something out here that may be counterintuitive, but I think it not only fits the scriptural pattern, but it also fits the pattern that we see in church history, even our church history. When God is moving, you would think that that always is a ubiquitous, unanimous kind of thing where everybody sees it and everybody craves it and everybody gets on board. But the history of the church shows something quite different. When the Spirit really begins to move, it doesn't always bring people together. And Exhibit A is right here, because the miracle of Lazarus didn't bring the Hebrew people together. It divided them. Many believed, but many were hostile to Jesus from this point forward. So the simple fact is, seeing a miracle doesn't lead to believing in Jesus. The chief priests and Pharisees, notice this in the text, they never reject the reality that Jesus is a miracle worker. There are signs everywhere. Some of you remember that old song from the 60s, right? Signs, signs, everywhere there's signs, right? It's kind of a rebellious song. In this context, though, there are signs everywhere. God is working through his son. It is a special moment in history when the miraculous power of God is flowing like a river. No pun intended to all this rain. It's flowing like a river. Everyone who wants to see a miracle only has to show up where Jesus is, and Jesus seems to show out. And though this was a powerful time, and many believed, and even these guys realized, look at verse 48, that if this continued, everyone would go after Jesus. What's interesting is that was not acceptable. If we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him. And then what will happen? The Romans are going to come in and they're going to take away our power, our influence, our traditions. You see, seeing isn't believing. Hearing isn't believing. If you look at verses, if you look with me for a second there, in chapter 12, you see that too. That's exactly what Isaiah is saying. You can see it, you can hear it, but that doesn't mean that you will see it. Because verse 40, some eyes are blinded, some hearts are hardened. They can't see, they can't hear. And God wants to heal these people, but they won't be healed. Hear me well. I believe that the Bible is one long story about God pouring out his blessings on people just like you and me, and people just like you and me experiencing those blessings and still not trusting in God. That's the story of the Hebrew children who took 40 years to take a few days trip, less than 2 week trip from Egypt to the promised land. It's the story of so many people who refuse to just listen to God and follow him and what he says. It is so easy to be near the faith and not live the life of faith. And over time, verse 37, if you look, though he had done so many signs before them, they still did not believe in him. At that point, it looks like they would not believe. But there's even in that verse, that word still, they still. Notice that word still. There's hope in that word. Maybe they will. Maybe still will go to will there. But the truth is, the longer the people rejected the truth of God, the would not becomes a could not. Look at verse 39. Therefore, they could not believe. Now, I want you to see that dynamic right there. I don't pretend to understand it completely, but you see it also in the life of Pharaoh. It just seems like as time goes on, he rejects God and his word and Moses, his prophet, again and again and again. And he goes from a point where you think maybe he might see it, he might get it, but then over time, the would not turns into a could not. Listen to me. If God is working in your heart this morning, brother, sister, hear me well. If God is working and you know he's working around you and you continue to reject him, your heart does not grow softer. It grows more hard, more calloused. And over time, the would not becomes a could not. And that's exactly what John's gospel tells us. Oh, friends, Isaiah, one of the greatest writing prophets, the first of the writing prophets, said, Lord, who has believed what he has heard from us, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? That's a beautiful thought that God reveals his strong and mighty arm. But we also know that, like Isaiah 6:10 says, it's quoted here, that some eyes have been blinded. And hearts hardened. They can't see anymore. They can't hear anymore. Some of the conversations I have with people, I fear that I'm hearing that kind of hard heart. And I'm talking about people who are not divorced from the church and the life of the church. Some of them have maybe even seen God move. But because of life and life circumstances, their hearts have grown not more warm by the gospel, but more cold by life's challenges. And blindness does set in. Blindness is a reality even in the church. It is easy for us to lose sight. It is easy for us to not listen. A heart far from God chooses not to see God. And it is a sad and tragic fact. Let me just ask you, I want you to think with me for just a moment, just in your heart, in your mind. Does God seem far from you? Have you felt like it's been a long time since there was deep, rich intimacy in your spiritual walk? Have you noticed a coldness gripping you? Well, listen, if you say yes, guess what? You are a human being. We all feel that from time to time. But if that continues for long periods of time without God's warmth and grace grabbing a hold of you and helping you, what that means is that you are not hearing the word. You are not allowing God to open your eyes. You are stuck. And sometimes being stuck doesn't mean that you're stuck in a particular sin. Sometimes it's a frame of mind. For me, I've noticed that it is easy to just lose joy for seasons and find that pulls me away from God. But listen to me, we need to understand that seeing isn't believing, that just because we come to church or just because we have a Christian heritage, we have to continue to choose to believe in God. The difference between a lost person and a saved person is the saved person continues on believing. We choose to believe. We choose to trust in God. We choose to follow Him no matter what the signs are, no matter if there are miracles around us or not. We continue to believe in God. We choose the Savior and we reject our sins. Friends, that's how we know we are a believer. Belief is also difficult because our wants, what we want, doesn't match up with God's offer. You will hear us talk often from this pulpit about idols of our hearts. In the old days, idols were little statues and things of that nature, but today idols can be material things or hobbies or pleasures of this world separated from the things of God. Many people in the world today who are non-believers are perfectly content with their lives. You know, we assume sometimes when we go share Jesus that those people that don't have Jesus are miserable. And then you go tell them, you need Jesus. And they're like, you know, I've got a good job. I've got everything I want. My family's healthy. I don't know what you're talking about. I don't sense any great need. We are always making a mistake if we always assume that the person apart from Jesus is miserable. Sometimes you just don't know what you're missing. Sometimes it's hard for you to grieve, right, when you don't know what you potentially could have. And so many lost people, if you go to them, and people who don't know Jesus, and you're assuming that they're the most miserable people, you may find that there's more miserable people at your church. In fact, I pretty much guarantee you will. Because we tend to really beat ourselves up. We say we believe in God, and we believe He loves us. We just don't seem too happy about it most of the time. And that's not a good thing. It's a bad witness, obviously. But listen to me, I hear so often when I'm talking to people who don't know the Lord, I'm expecting to hear some great tragedy or something like that. Not at all. They just don't need anything in their minds. But friends, here's the problem. What they want is not what's best. Just because you have something good in your life doesn't mean you have what's best. And people who have good lives, everything they want in this life doesn't mean that they have any spiritual peace. They've just learned how to ignore that part of their lives, that part of their souls. Belief is difficult to perceive when you have everything you want. What did Jesus say about the difficulty of a rich man getting into heaven? You see the connection there? It'd be easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle. That's what he's saying. He's saying that so many people, their wants are being met by this world. And so therefore, they don't have any more wants. They are content where they are. But they're feeding on things that do not feed their souls. Some have done studies lately about these guys and gals who like to just eat like McDonald's French fries, and that's the only thing they'll eat. Well, obviously, you can stay alive on that kind of food, but you're not going to thrive. There's something better. And I think that so many people in this world, they're gorging themselves on the stuff they have instead of the Savior that they need. In this passage, if you'll look, the chief priests and Pharisees, they do respect Jesus' power. We've already mentioned this. Look at verse 47 of the 11th chapter. But here's what they see. They don't see power to change their lives. They, in a spiritual sense, they see power that will change their lives in a physical sense. Notice their number one concern in verse 48. Look at verse 48 with me. If we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him, and the Romans will come and take away both our place and our nation. Be careful when it's all about you, my ministry, our place, our role. When we start talking about things in the first person or we take too much credit, here's what's going to happen. When God starts moving and he starts showing you that he's going to start taking things away from you that you thought were yours and you thought were necessary, all of a sudden, even if it is God, even if it is miraculous, even if it is clear in the Word of God, you will push against it because you don't want to lose what's mine, what's yours, what's ours. These are men who have a very subtle and extremely dangerous spiritual problem. They think what they want is what God wants, but they don't have biblical proof of that. They're following their hearts because their hearts have convinced themselves that they are right. And these individuals who are the top religious authorities of their day, they stand against God himself to the point that they will, instead of having their power killed, they resolve to kill the man who might take away their power. Now, if you look closely at verses 49 and 50 and following, you'll see that the high priest Caiaphas is on to this. He knows that Jesus is a powerful figure and that if his power is going to be preserved, this man must die. And so a prophecy is spoken through Caiaphas where he actually, though he's speaking against Jesus, he speaks truth because he says this man's going to die for the nation and he's going to draw people from everywhere to himself. And that's exactly what happens. And he says it in a negative fashion, but as only God can do, God fulfills it in a positive fashion. He uses the death of Jesus to bring the children of God who are scattered abroad back home. In verses 51 and 52. You see, the Pharisees and the chief priests, they want to keep the status quo. They have wants, religious wants, but they are wicked and deceitful. Let me say this again, and this goes for everybody in the room, especially the guy on the platform. Don't kid yourself. We cannot kid ourselves into thinking that what we want is always what God wants. This is a path towards certain destruction because our hearts are wicked and will mislead us. Only the Word of God can keep us from making this mistake. If you start with your heart, you're going to end up in trouble. But if you start with the Word of God, you will find a clear path to the Messiah. Friends, faith and religion and all of these things are good and helpful in culture, but they will not be enough if we are not connected to the power of the Holy Spirit. And this is where it gets difficult. Our third point is, why is faith so difficult? Because we want religion more than God. Now, I want to be careful here because I don't buy in to the idea that religion and just everything about religion is negative or wrong, because I do believe that God gives us the wisdom to read the Word of God and to come up with liturgies and methods of worship and things that the world's going to call religious. There's nothing wrong with that. If we have a biblically based liturgy, a biblically based way of worshiping God, that's perfectly fine, and people are going to see that as religious. But I want you to realize that no matter what we call it, there cannot be a chasm between what we do, which is viewed as religious, and the glory of God. If what we're doing is for God, it will be empowered with the glory of God. And this is where we can see the big separator, the big difference maker between those who have a cold religion and those who have a close relationship with Christ. The close relationship with Christ will be filled with glory. That life will be filled with glory. The prophets and the apostles knew the glory of God in a unique way. The Word of God was revealed to them. We may not have quite that connection, but through their Word, we can connect with the glory that they basked in, that they experienced. The Word of God is a connector to all these signs. The Word of God is a bridge to all these amazing things that God has done throughout the years that can help us understand how powerful He is and how He changes the world. Religion, apart from the glory of God, will always try to make the world a better place. And believe me, the world needs to be a better place. But the world needs more than us being a good nonprofit organization, doing nonprofit kind of projects in the community. Though those things are good and open up doors for evangelism, hear me, the most important thing the church does is that we reveal the glory of God through the preaching of the gospel. We tell people the story of Jesus, that he lived and that he died and that he rose again. And when we're doing that faithfully, yes, that will involve religious elements where we are actually connecting with people, where we're serving people, where we're all being good deacons in that sense, that we're serving the needs of our community. That's a wonderful thing. But ultimately, our job is to tell people and show people the glory of God in Jesus Christ. Because some people, some of us, can sometimes be quite satisfied with just religious observance. Just going through the motions. Just being faithful to our heritage. Those are good things. They can often guide us in the right direction, but they're penultimate as opposed to ultimate. They're a lesser thing. Because ultimately, what we need is not just the same old, but what we need is a continual infilling of God's glory and power. We need every day a fresh wind and a fresh fire like the disciples, the apostles experienced in the early chapters of Acts. We need to be filled with the Holy Spirit because this world needs not just another religious nonprofit. What this world needs is a gospel preaching fellowship filled with love. Filled with the hope of Jesus. In chapter 12, verse 43, our last verse that we read, I believe shows us what happens when we lose sight of heaven's glory. What we do is we cave into this kind of glory, glory that comes from man, more than glory that comes from God. Too often, churches are trying to seek the approval of the culture, to get the approval of human beings. And when we do that, we will not find the glory of God. Too many of us have feared the wrath of man more than we have yearned for the glory of God. Let me say this. Do I have your undivided attention? If the culture continues to go in the direction of anti-religious liberty, you see, you can talk about all the other hot topics of the day you want to. But let me tell you the one you need to be listening to the most. It's all about religious liberty. The more the culture can convince the masses that what we preach and teach is bigoted and hateful and full of hatred, we are going to have to realize that no longer are we going to have the approval of man, tax-exempt status, etc., etc., etc. We are going to have to stand for our faith and depend on the glory of God. Because if you think that being popular and getting the praise of others in the world is the number one priority, then Christianity is about to get much more difficult for you and for all of us. We need to understand that the only thing that's going to carry us through is true faith and the real glory of God. If we're not careful, even good men can be driven to bad decisions by misplaced fear. In chapter 12, verse 42, nevertheless, many, even of the authorities, believed in him, but for the fear of the Pharisees, they did not confess it so that they would not be put out of the synagogue. Now, let me get this straight. They were more worried about getting kicked out of synagogue. Let's use the word church there. Synagogue means a gathering. Church means a gathering. They're obviously, one's Jewish and one's more Christian in inference, but let's just put those two words together. Do you see that the ultimate concern wasn't the glory of God? The ultimate concern was staying in the good stead of the religious community. In other words, they were ready and willing to exchange the power of God for the prestige of man. That is a faith that is not based on pleasing God. How much of your faith is focused on pleasing God? How much of your faith is spent trying to convince other people that you are godly? You see, there are two different things. One is the way of glory. The other is the way of religion. The way of religion spends more time trying to convince people that you've got God. The way of Christ just gives you no more time than to let the glory of God shine through you. And many people are more than satisfied with putting on appearances. I challenge you to look at this text later. Chapter 11 and chapter 12. There isn't one non-religious person in it. In these passages, the good guys and the bad guys, there isn't like this atheist agnostic set. In this text, everybody involved is, from one perspective, religious, but not everyone is seeking the glory of God. Friends, this is such an important thing for the church to understand, because too often we believe that the trappings of our religion are enough to win the day. They are not. Only the glory of God working through your religion will make a difference. Only a true transformation of the heart can lead to God doing great things. Caiaphas and even Joseph of Arimathea, we're going to find out later in John's gospel, are willing to compromise their belief in Jesus to get along with the religious authorities. And I'm here to tell you that, church, we cannot make this mistake moving forward, because in our culture, we are going to discover that hard choices are going to have to be made, that to follow Jesus is going to require more of us moving, more from us moving forward than we've had required of us in the past. There is no easy way forward, but there is the glory of God that can fill us. Friends, I believe that here in this passage, we see a strong warning against being merely religious. We need Jesus. This morning, I want to tell you that faith is a rich gift. It is a beautiful gift from a God who loves you. He loves you more than your mind can even begin to fathom. The more I read about Jesus in the Gospels, the more I am convinced that I have yet to scratch the surface of the deep, deep love of Jesus. He loves me more than my finite mind can fathom, and He loves you too. And today, I know that some of you are going through difficult times, and maybe you would be tempted to follow Jesus and see it as some kind of coping mechanism. And yes, I will tell you, when you have Jesus, you do have hope in the face of death and disease and disaster and all those terrible things. But listen to me, you need more than just a coping mechanism. Jesus Christ is more than your coping mechanism. He is your life changer. He is your soul savior. He is everything you need. He is your life when He becomes your Lord. And when you follow Him, He gives you joy in the midst of the storm. He gives you peace in the midst of terrible, terrible problems. He is powerful, and He loves you, and He wants to show you that. The gospel way is the only way forward in this world, because it's the only way that leads beyond this world to heaven and eternal life. And we want you to believe this morning, because we know that it is the best thing that you can experience to know Jesus, to know Him crucified and risen again for your heart and soul. That is the most beautiful thing in the world. And though this morning we could have great signs, I could get up here and do an Ozzie Smith and do cartwheels and somersaults and all those things, and you might be entertained and walk right out of here as lost as ever. We may even see a miracle in our midst. But if you have a hard heart, you'll always find an excuse, a reason not to believe. Because belief is supernatural, and that ain't natural. Supernatural, not natural. It's something God does. It's something that only God can do to get you past your doubts and skepticism this morning. It's not an easy thing, nor is it a given thing, but it is a God thing. And He will do it. Luke 1:37 tells us that nothing is impossible with God, and that means even changing your heart or mine. Here's a sad commentary as we conclude. John 11:54. Because of the lack of faith that was surrounding Him, it says there that Jesus no longer walked openly among the Jews. How many miracles were missed? How many sermons were unheard? All because of unbelief. Here's what scares me, is that if there's unbelief in the church, if we don't live by faith, even in the church, then sooner or later we'll start missing the miracles and we'll start missing the sermons and we'll literally die. The only way we live is if we open our hearts to the glory of God and ask Him to truly do a work of transformation in us. His love is great. Have you felt that love? Do you know that peace? Because if you haven't known that love and known that peace, I believe that's why God brought you here this morning. He has a word for you. And it's not a word of unbelief. It's a word of belief. He is telling you to walk away from your wants, your religion, whatever it is, your past. He's offering you a path of glory where the Son of God will fill your heart. That is what He offers. Will you receive it? Belief is the hardest thing. It's not natural. But belief is very possible because Christ is here now. Believe in Him. Let's pray. Lord, we need to believe. Just like the Greeks in chapter 12, verse 20 through 26, who say, "Sir, we must see Jesus." I pray that we will have faith like those Gentiles. Tucked into this text, surrounded by unbelief by the Jews, there are a handful of Gentiles who say, "We want to see Jesus." And this morning, I just pray that there will be a handful of people who say above all else, "Lord, I want to see You. I want to know You. I want to know the power of salvation in my life." Oh God, we believe, but help our unbelief. Help us see. Help us trust in You. Save us, O Lord. We pray in Jesus' name.